Sort of to move forward. Because these folks like Rob, like folks like you, Bob Devin, and the spice is what makes a great dish. You don't have to have a lot of spice to make for a flavorful dish, but you need some, otherwise, bland dish. Well, communities need some spicy people as well. The ones who don't see the problem in the same way, maybe come up with some wildly different stuff and stuff that we might actually be able to. I know, as spicy as Zach and as the mayor might actually want to be, they're constrained. They have all kinds of constraints around what they can and cannot do by the virtue of the nature of their jobs, right? So I think they'd love to see some of you guys step up and do something weird, wacky, and wonderful in there. And that's kind of what we're trying to get at. Because collectively, we're going to be much smarter about this, you know. And when we start adding more to the mix, it's sort of the crazy thing, you know, I had no idea this would actually, you know, be of interest to other people, but turns out it actually might. So yeah, that is what we're here today to talk about. So with that, I'm not a big rules guy, but I put this up there anyway. So here's the aspirations for the day. Let's say yes and. Now, we've got some very smart people here who've been around the block a few times, and very, you know, we've got a lot of experience in the room on projects. And somebody's gonna come up and say, hey, how about if we did this? And somebody's gonna say, well, you know, you can't do that because this, and this. Like, let's hold that thought, if we will, you know, because that it's easy to say, well, we've been down that road, we can't do this. Well, you said, well, you could do it, but you'd have to do this if you did this, and this. Like, okay, that's fine. So let's try to say yes. Let's ask some crazy what if questions. Let's obviously respect other people's viewpoints. And of course, I'd like us to have a little bit of fun in doing this. So take your official hat off and maybe wear your citizen hat here a little bit more today. All right, so here's what we're going to do to get you guys up and moving. You notice in front of you, you have a post-it note, you have a marker here. All right, here's what I'd like you to do. I want you to write down something that you love about independence. Could be a big thing, could be a small thing, could be a person, could be a time of year, but something. And here's what we're going to do. We've got a microphone up here, although if you guys, I'm going to use the microphone. Use my phone. What I'm going to do is start forming a line over here. This is on.
There we go. Testing.
So why don't you come here? Tell us what you love about independence. Big thing, little thing, whatever. Say it loud and proud in the microphone. Hand it to the next person over here. And then let's put this up here. We're going to call this one the Wall of Love. And I got mine. I had this today. I love Clinton's root beer float. Kind of awesome, right? And just what a great sort of atmosphere as well. Definitely, that place is a love note. But yeah, I think your root beer floats here kind of awesome. I've seen some other good stuff, but that's the one I'm going with right now. So, and we put it up here. All right, what do you love about this? This is not a hard question. So let's form a line up here. First one gets it here, then again, hand it back to the next one.
That's easy.
Come on, people.
Write it down, and we're going to put it on the Wall of Love. Loud and proud.
Historic sites.
There's just a few here, right?
The small town feel.
Independence squares and the unique shops and restaurants.
Bass Pro Park.
I live on Main Street, so I love Main Street and all the great things that are on it.
The topography of Independence. Little Blue Trace.
Harry Truman walking sign.
The people.
Independence Academies. Walking trails.
I should say park because I volunteered for it. Santa Calico.
There you go.
Hi, boy.
It's home. Diversity and digital cultures.
You inspired me with root beer shake. I love a high boy strawberry shake.
Awesome. Here you go.
Square.
Pass back over here. Yeah.
Bowling and diamond.
The 4th of July bicycle parade.
Oh, yeah.
The square has come back to life.
Oh, yeah. Fairmount.
Just a little history. The community.
The square in the evening.
That's good.
My grandparents' house in Old Independence.
Sense of community and people working together.
And people love this country.
Excuse me.
The people that love this country.
Old Polsky.
Franklin Field.
History.
Little Blue Trace Trail.
I had to trim the library to take them. I love the city administration, how about that?
City administration?
City administration.
I put walkable square.
The city administration.
I feel like we need to shut up. But I put history.
That was mine, especially pioneer history.
The restaurant's on the square.
Another Truman Library fan?
I second McCoy Park.
I understand everyone is wrong. But I'm in the business.
I put the feeling at home in Poppy's Donuts.
Besides city administration?
The independent charter. It is.
The atmosphere at courthouse exchange.
Square in downtown.
My son's personal favorite Pokemon hunting on the square.
The Bengal Brothers.
That's interesting.
Queen City Baseball.
Bengals.
Oh, there you go. All right.
Two brothers and one player. They're two.
Mike Trout.
They're very close.
All right, not bad. Now, you did. People said, oh, you took mine. You don't take somebody else.
This is a joke.
It's all good. And I think that's kind of cool when you start hearing stuff that other people love, the same thing where it's like, oh yeah, I love that too. You know, not one mention of the word, you know, paved roads and with all deference to the police and the fire service. Like, yeah, of course, we expect those guys. And we do love what they do, but that's not necessarily why we resonate with the place. So these kinds of things absolutely do matter. You've heard things over and over again, you know, your history, your public administration, all that stuff. The square, obviously, the trails, those kind of things come up over and over again. So, oh, that's good. These are some things that you guys love, and certainly that probably when we ask the broader community, they probably say very similar things. Well done there. And then there's some, you know, some totally, you know, idiosyncratic things, koi pond there. You know, that's cool. The Pokemon Go kind of stuff. Well done. All right, so we've got you guys up, we've got you guys thinking. So, what we're going to do, so we did the wall of love. There we go. All right, our first bigger exercise here. I think we've got about, well, just about 50 people. This should actually work. Normally we do this in places where I have you working at tables, but we're going to maybe have, so you've got to break off into like groups of five, maybe six. So you guys come down here. So there's four chairs, we might end up having to swing a few chairs down here, but we'll get there. All right, so I'm actually a big believer in the power of a t-shirt. I love t-shirts, I mostly live in t-shirts. But a t-shirt, when we put on a t-shirt, it's not just about, you know, sort of an article of clothing. Because t-shirts inevitably have sort of a message, a team, a brand, something. So it's like a public display of affection for something, right? So like this one, that's, you know, Michigan, the love thing, they hold up the thumb there, I think that's kind of cool. But you see a lot of t-shirts that are maybe like this. I visited Sedona, Arizona. It's like, that kind of t-shirt, it's like, okay, tourists would maybe buy these t-shirts. Like, okay, not too bad. You're visiting a place. Chances are you probably bought, you know, some sort of tourist t-shirt there as well. But stuff that's maybe a little bit different, the kind of t-shirt that maybe has a little bit more meaning. Now, when Joplin was hit by that huge tornado 6 years ago, 2011, I believe, yeah. So I visited there about 4 years ago, and they said that the interesting story around this t-shirt, that within a matter of days after that tornado hit, the local print company made these t-shirts and they just started handing them out. And think about that. That was an opportunity. That was a time when people were, this was not just something you wore to cover your body, this was something, this is a declaration saying, you know what, we're going to restore jobs, we're going to rebuild, you know, this city. So sometimes these messages are incredibly important. I understand when I visited there again 4 years ago, 2 years after the fact, they were still very proud of these t-shirts. You still saw, you know, people wearing them. They were still selling them all, in all the local shops there as well. And this one, I'm originally from Akron, Ohio, me and LeBron James, right? And this is a little hard to read, but this says Akron 1825, which is when it was founded. Down here it says Akron, where the weak are killed and eaten. It's not technically true, but it has to do with sort of that Rust Belt sort of attitude that a lot of, you know, Rust Belt cities have sort of adopted over time. You know, a little bit of swag, there. Because Rust Belt cities have taken pretty hard in the last generation or so. So they developed sort of, you know, a little bit of an attitude, a little bit of a sense of humor.
Well, and some kind, sometimes a little bit of a thick skin. Like Detroit, there's all kinds of stuff around Detroit. Detroit Lives, Made in Detroit, Pure Detroit. There's a number of companies that are out there that are producing these amazing sort of Detroit t-shirts, or this one. Now, I know that, you know, I understand the state is sort of divided into two sort of warring factions, as it were. But when I first met the guys who make this is STL, this is from these guys. This is Jeff and Randy Vines from the STL Style House down there in St. Louis. They're on Cherokee Street. And I met them several years ago when I was writing the first book. And what they did is they said they're in the business of selling local pride. They said, we make t-shirts for locals, not t-shirts for tourists. Wow, that's kind of cool there. So the STL Style House is very much about all things related to St. Louis, and somewhat also about Missouri there as well. And they're there in Cherokee Street. So the selling local pride turns out is actually a pretty good business. This is Lauren Tom, and she owns a company called Flirty Girl in New Orleans. You know, Fleur-de-Lis, Flirty Girl. And so now she's opened up 4 stores in and around New Orleans and sell New Orleans themed clothing. And again, this is one of those things, it's like after people thought they had lost their city, there was a whole sort of rush around, wow, we do love this city. And it kind of manifested, I think, in some interesting ways there. So selling local pride. This is one of her t-shirts. This one's a little hard to read, so I put this out. This one says neutral ground side, and then this one says sidewalk side. Now, have any of you folks been to Mardi Gras in New Orleans? Yeah, not a few heads. This is, you know. So this has to do with which side of the street you watch Mardi Gras from. Because the Mardi Gras is like a big giant parade. It's like a big donut. So you're either inside the donut or you're outside the donut, right? Neutral ground side or sidewalk side. So this is my friend Robert Fogarty here. He said he was wearing this t-shirt when he was in Thailand. And somebody walked up and goes, hey, New Orleans. He thought, wow, that's kind of cool. Now what was interesting about that is nowhere on this t-shirt does it say New Orleans or Mardi Gras. No, you had to know something about the city and about Mardi Gras to get that particular reference. And he thought, that was cool. Halfway around the world, somebody knows my city there as well. So again, a little bit of inside baseball, but yeah, very cool. Or how about this one? You guys know this one, Keep Austin Weird? This could become sort of the de facto state motto there in Texas. But this actually starts out like about 20 years ago or so. It starts out as a buy local campaign. So you want to keep Austin, you want to keep Austin authentic, you want to keep Austin weird, you buy local. But of course, it's grown into something much bigger, and now if you visit Austin, you're almost obligated to buy some kind of thing that says keep Austin weird. So yeah, pretty cool. Now what's funny about this is I was told at some point later, this guy's actually giving an Aggie symbol there, because you know they do the hook of horns. This guy's giving the Texas A&M symbol on this. All right, that's kind of interesting. Again, another war between warring factions and cultural war. This one, I'm from Akron, Ohio, but I still have a lot of love for Northeast Ohio. This one was for sale by the local Convention Visitors Bureau up there. It says, Cleve, land that I love. Oh, that's pretty cool. And I actually put this shirt on, I remember about 3 years ago when LeBron announced that he was coming back to Northeast Ohio to the Cavaliers, and that was a good day there as well. So yeah, Cleve, land that I love, not too bad. Or how about this one? I saw this one, they're over at Clinton's today. Yeah, Polly's Pop. Probably many of you grew up drinking Polly's Pop. And how cool that it's actually sort of come full circle and now they're actually producing it there again. Now, for those of you who remember it as a kid and now, does it taste the same? I'm just kind of curious. I won't tell the McLeans.
You know. Yes.
Yes? Okay. So, but yeah, it's, you know, hopefully yes. But I heard the great story of how it actually sort of came about. Coming back there as well. But yeah, definitely something like this. Cool t-shirt. Or how about this? It says, Peace, Love, and Fitness, Tallahassee, Florida. So apparently for the last few years, there's a guy in Tallahassee, Florida who's been riding around the city on a bike in nothing but a headband and a thong. And I'm told him, he didn't worry, this is what he looks like, right? So again, you would totally have to know Tallahassee, Florida, and you've been there to get this particular reference. Peace, Love, Fitness, Tallahassee, Florida. So I was doing this workshop in Garland, Texas. This would be about 4 years ago. And I show this slide, and from the back of the room, I hear this, oh my God. And this woman came up to me during the break and says, hey, I went to FSU. I've seen that guy. He really does look like that. So she had seen him, and she totally got that particular reference. So again, total inside baseball there. Yeah. Or this one, Sunshine City. I live in St. Petersburg, Florida. Now, Florida is, we're the Sunshine State, Sunshine City, I don't know. We actually just skirted, you know, a hurricane, you know, Irma. But I like the notion Sunshine City. I think some other stuff maybe around the park, but not too bad. I'll give that one a B minus, maybe a C plus on that, or this one. I visited a town called Charlotte, Michigan. Not Charlotte, Charlotte, spelled the same way. Charlotte is about 20 minutes southwest of Lansing there. And so one of the t-shirts they came up with was, you know, it's again the mitten sign, Charlotte of love, whole lot of love, Charlotte of love. That's pretty clever, well done there. Or maybe this one, I've visited Anchorage a couple times. Anchorage, it says Alaska with plumbing. Now, if you go to Alaska, this is kind of a thing, right? Because Alaska is a different kind of place. And there's large parts of Alaska that actually don't have any indoor plumbing. So they say, Alaska with plumbing. It's like, all right, well done there. Or this one, it says, show me the moose, right? So in Anchorage, Alaska, at any given time, there are literally dozens of moose running around the city. So when Michelle and I were there, we've been there twice, she was like desperate to see a moose. So she's always asking people, hey, have you seen a moose? And everybody has a moose story. Says, oh yeah, I saw one last week, or one in my neighborhood, or yeah, this one time, this one chased me or did something. So everybody has a moose story. We didn't see any moose while we were there, but we remained hopeful going back. But I just love the picture there as well. So again, you kind of have to know your local city. Or this one. Remember, I'm from Akron, Ohio? Every year's a good year in Akron, Ohio. Yeah. Goodyear, tire rubber, and again, the Goodyear blimp. Yeah, that's pretty cool, playing on that local, that icon that is the blimp. Blimps have a very interesting sound. I don't know if you've ever heard them there, but, you know, as a kid, they would fly around the city. You see them pretty regularly. So, yeah, you go to your night, like, what is it? Oh, it's the blimp. Or this one. This is definitely some inside baseball. This says, get blown away in Goleta, CA. Goleta, California is there in Southern California, adjacent to Santa Barbara. Now, Goleta, California has the interesting distinction of being the only mainland U.S. city that was actually shelled by the Japanese during World War II. So in early 1942, this Japanese submarine surfaces off the coast of Goleta and opens fire on this little oil refinery that was there on the coast, thinking it was actually Los Angeles, right? So they drew this particular image there. The Japanese submarines surfing off there, get blown away, Goleta, CA. So again, you totally have to know your local history to appreciate that particular reference. Or how about this one? Slow. San Luis Obispo, right? It's actually known as one of the happiest cities in the world. They've done studies on this. And Slow, San Luis Obispo, ends up on this list. Now, people there, the locals, they don't call it San Luis Obispo because that's a mouthful. They just call it Slow. Oh, where are you from? I'm from Slow. Oh, have you been to Slow? Yeah. So what they did with this one is they took the Slow thing, they made it into a face with a smile. Oh, that's really good. Well done there. Sort of playing off. Sort of that local identity and that particular thing, well done. Or this one, it says, that's so Sedona. You ever been to Sedona, Arizona? Sedona, Arizona is the home of a bunch of like vortices, these psychic vortexes that are there, and there's all kinds of psychic photographers and tarot readers and palm readers and whatnot. In fact, you can't swing a dead cat without hitting like a psychic photographer or a tarot reader. Try to find an accountant in Sedona. That would be hard. But, you know, psychic readers, tarot readers, all that stuff, yes, you can absolutely find it. So they know that the rest of the outside world probably looks at them like, those guys are crazy. They said, you know what, fine, we're going to own that. So they said, you know, that's so Sedona. So you have the vortexes here, and they're sort of owning their own weirdness. Like, all right, that's kind of cool. So with that in mind, here's the question. What is independence? Independence's, there's a mouthful. What's Independence's t-shirt? I know we've seen poppies, somebody gave me the I Heart Independence, great shirt. But what's something that you guys as locals would actually think is cool? Something that tells a story that maybe you guys you have to be from here to kind of get. And that's our first challenge here. So here's what we want to do. Let's maybe bring a couple extra chairs down here. So let's get five out here. We've got six tables out front here. We should have enough. So t-shirt design. Pair you guys pair up your teams here. We're going to give you guys about 10 minutes. I want you to design a t-shirt. If you want to do front and back, you can do that. Because on each of these things, there's some crayons, there's some markers. Bring your markers down, that'd be helpful too. And there's an outline of the t-shirt here as well. So come up with a t-shirt that you guys as locals would actually think is cool and would actually wear. And then what's going to happen is we'll give you guys about 10 minutes, and then we're going to have each team report out there as well. Okay, so if you're not presenting, go grab a seat. If you're not presenting, come over here for the wings. It's just like a big stage. Waiting for the wings for your entrance.
they had that down the Oakland.
All right.
And that street. See, usually they do that before they do it. That's what's weird.
All right, the rest of you guys, come on in, grab a seat.
Yeah. Huh. Okay.
You may think you have the coolest t-shirt, but you might see something.
Testing. All right, here we go. Okay, Cindy, you want to tell us? No, here we go. We're going to start putting the posting on the wall here, so moving around here, and then you like the side.
Okay.
Yeah, tell them, no, you got to show them first. Here, I'll hold the other side. What do you got?
Okay, we have a t-shirt with a number on it. Anybody know what it is?
33, this is really right.
Where is this at?
Walk this way, 219.
219, Delaware. 219, Delaware.
Okay, I'm the outsider. What is it?
President Truman.
Oh, okay. And he walks, he has a statue to walk.
He's always walking this way.
There you go.
Walk
this way, 219. Again, local knowledge. Well done. All right, very good. Let's go this side. Come on. Here. Bounce back and forth. Are we hold the other side? All right. What do you got?
Okay.
Hold this. Wait, hold this. So, what's the story on that?
Oh my god!
Oh,
you didn't say it on the door!
I must have missed that somehow. Yeah. Men and women, I think? Mostly men. Alright, t-shirts. Did you have another one under here?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So, you know what? Tell you what. If you would take this one back to the. Oh, wait, somehow we just got. Alright, never mind, you're good. All right, thank you, Kristen. All right, sit with that one up there on the wall. All right. Come on over here. What do we got there, sir?
Inspired by Nolan Road, Independence, the Miracle by Amon. And, you know, we had some stuff. This was inspired by Frank White thinking Nolan Road. He remembered the Miracle Mile. On the back, I love Joel Rod Country.
Oh, how many of you remember?
How many of you remember?
I win my bet.
All right, so explain to me what's Miracle by a Mile. Well, Miracle Mile is the car dealership.
Car dealership, right. Known as Miracle Mile.
Okay.
And Independence is the Miracle
by
a Mile.
I did. All right, well done.
Thank you.
All right, so, all right, I got this one. All right, there you go. Thanks. All right, John, here. Give me that. I'll put this one up.
Well, Independence is known as the Queen City of the Trails, so that's sort of our theme. All trails lead home.
Oh, I like that.
Oh, very good.
We had much more fun with the other one, obviously.
I like it. Yeah, see that one up there? All right, let's go over here.
All right, we all know Independence. Spelling it half the time, I know when I type it, I spell it wrong the first time, and you realize you spelled it wrong the first time, so you go back and you cross it out, and you spell it again, and you're like, sure, I did it again, and finally we are in depth mode. It's a lot easier.
In depth mode. All right. Very good. All right, what do you got over here?
Hi, so the idea of our team was to kind of, instead of focusing on the historical aspect, it was kind of to move forward with where we're at and kind of an inclusive mindset about all the diversity that's come into the city. So my favorite is our tiny green hand at the bottom.
Yes.
So we have a lot of Martians living here.
Yes, we do.
Green lives matter. Green lives matter.
Green lives matter.
All right.
Great. Good work for you today.
Independence for all. All right.
And none of them
wear t-shirts. So our offer is the best t-shirt design is going to be printed and sold in all states. Independence, Delaware, I'm committed to that. So anyway, so our t-shirt is History Happens Here, and it's a says Independence across the top, and then on the back it lists, you know, like a rock band tour. It says Harry Truman, Ginger Rogers, Paul Henning, Joseph Smith, Hiram Young, Thomas Rowe, Jesse James, Charlie Ross, George Caleb Bingham, Rick Sutcliffe, Albert Pujols. And so the idea is that history isn't one thing, but it's a series of people who've been in the community for a long, long period of time, and a lot of people won't know. And say, well, who's that? And that's the opportunity to talk about that. So it's happens. It's present tense. It's not past tense.
Nice. Well done. All right, Mark. There we go.
Yeah, I got to give a red hat for this one. This is a shirt that we're going to say that you can't wear out of town. You have to only wear this in town. Don't mess with Independence.
No, they were gambling on that one. It's okay.
No, for some reason, wait. So, if somebody, if an outsider says something bad about you guys, that hurts, it stinks. But when we own our own, you know, our own bad history, our own negative history, we diffuse it, we deflect it, we take away its power. So having a little bit of sense of humor, being able to laugh about something like that now, that means something. Now maybe you don't actually produce the t-shirt. I kind of do. But the fact that it's like somebody thought of that, it's like, that's okay. Again, sort of owning your own weirdness, owning your own history, you take away a lot of the, you know, an outsider's ability to make that, to turn that into a negative. So think of it that way. So well done on that. Where we got over here.
Thought of our idea about 12 seconds before the end of the day. It's part of that, part of the artwork. But it says, Harry S. Truman's Independence, where punctuation is optional. It has an arrow to a period after Harry S.
Truman. Oh, there you go. There yes. All right. Very good. We'll put that on the doorway or, sort of on, or below those there would be good. Yeah, we'll keep it all on one wall.
Okay, so sort of a play on something that's already existing. We've got the hashtag Love the Square already going up on the square. But this is a little different graphic look at it, and pretty simple.
Love the Square. Love the square.
Hashtag Love the.
Yeah. There we go. Simple. And I love embracing that bad thing. We got to get it. We got to get that. So.
Yeah. All right. Let's put that on the wall there. All right. All right. Last one. What do we got?
We also failed the art test, and we didn't have an artist. Ours says, get your Polly popped in Independence.
That's a real thing. There's a print shop for the students, and then somebody here owns one of the
Harper Copy. Where's
Tom? Harper Copy, Tom.
No.
Yeah, I asked Tom before. He said they don't actually do the t-shirts.
Oh.
Sunshine Graphics. There's anybody from Sunshine here? Or I know the student, you know, JC said the students do t-shirts and printables and stuff like that. Yeah. So maybe if one of these t-shirts might actually be, take that and that the core idea, maybe have that do with some actual design work around it. I don't know. Maybe you do this on an annual basis. You know, a citywide t-shirt contest. I mean, look what we did in like 15 minutes here. Well, imagine if you threw this open to the broad community and asked them to come up with stuff, right? And they post sort of all the options on Facebook. There's gonna be some wildly funny, some painful stuff, some poignant stuff, some wildly inappropriate stuff, and that's okay there. But you're gonna laugh, you're gonna think, you go, okay, and then maybe you cull it down to a handful and you let people vote, and that's gonna be the official t-shirt. For the year. Maybe that's sold somewhere, you know, in the square, in some of the shops. I don't know. But there's all kinds of stuff. A t-shirt is powerful. You know, and when you laugh about this, hopefully there's something in there that goes, maybe we can actually do something interesting. All right, so well done then. Okay. All right, before I turn you guys loose for sort of the last exercise, I want to load your head up with a few things to get you thinking about some stuff. I should unload my phone as well. A few things to think about. Rituals and traditions. Families have them, schools have them, and cities have some of the most amazing rituals and traditions out there as well. And one of my favorites is actually from Providence, Rhode Island. This is called Waterfront.
And it was started about 25 years ago in an attempt for Providence to sort of reclaim and rediscover their river. So what they did is they commissioned an artist by the name of Barnaby Evans to come in, and what Barnaby did was remarkably simple. They brought in these braziers, anchored them in the middle of the river, they bring in cords of pine wood, and they light them on fire. It's water and fire. It's the most basic thing in the world, and it is absolutely magical. Because you go down there for a water fire event, smell that pine smoke, hear the crackle of that wood, see these great dancing shadows that are created all over the city, because it's essentially like a giant bonfire on the river. And every one of us, we've probably sat in front of a campfire or a bonfire and been absolutely mesmerized by the experience, right? There's something in our human nature that we can watch fire and be incredibly content. Imagine taking that experience to a municipal level and you have water fire. And a few years ago, I was lucky enough to participate in what they call a lighting ceremony. And sort of like the villagers from a Frankenstein movie, we carried these torches from City Hall down to the riverfront, we put the torches into this urn, and from the urn they light water fire. Very cool. It was always informed the way I think and feel about Providence. This is a fun one. This is a little town in western Massachusetts called Shelburne Falls. And this is the Iron Bridge. And 364 days out of the year, the Iron Bridge has cars and trucks that go back and forth across it. But for one night out of the year, and for the last dozen years or so, it's been in August, they close down the river, close down the bridge, and they have dinner on it. Now, the local restaurants cater the event. They bring in the linen tablecloths, linen napkins. Students are the waiters and waitresses. And it's a giant fundraiser for the Chamber of Commerce. Very cool. Now, you may go across this bridge every day, going to and from work, to and from school, something like that. I guarantee you, having dinner on that bridge will make you see and feel that bridge differently, and make you see and feel your city differently as well. And it sort of begs the question, what could you have dinner on here in Independence? What could you have brunch on here in Independence? It might actually help people see and feel the city differently. This is a really good idea that you guys absolutely should steal, and do something uniquely you with it. And if you do, let me know, because I'm always curious to see how other communities sort of take this idea and make it sort of uniquely their own. Again, really, kind of, this is a simple and a great idea. Maybe somebody is going, you can do that there, or there, or there. So hopefully you can do it. This is a fun one, Rituals and Traditions from Tacoma, Washington. Tacoma's up there in the greater Seattle area, and now the whole Pacific Northwest is really well known for glass art. Mostly because of a guy by the name of Dale Chihuly. He's a guy who does that amazing sort of flower-like glass. He's got an eye patch. He kind of looks like a pirate. So you guys probably know who Dale Chihuly is. But in addition to him, there's this huge culture of glass art up there in the Pacific Northwest, especially in Tacoma, which happens to be his hometown, where he is born. And this is the Chihuly Bridge. So there's actually his work that's sort of embedded permanently on exhibit in this actual city bridge. It's kind of amazing. So what happened, though, was about 15 years ago, a local artist kind of got the idea to wanted to do something kind of fun and creative for her community there, as co-creators are wont to do. And so what she did is she happened to be inspired by, it happened to be the Chinese year of the monkey at that time. So she inspired by the monkey, and she made these ornaments there that were sort of inspired by the Chinese year of the monkey. And they kind of look something like these, initially, right? And she called them monkey balls. And she made a couple dozen of them, and she hid them in her neighborhood and just let people sort of find them. So it was like this serendipitous, hey, this scavenger hunt. I didn't even know I was on a scavenger hunt, but I found this amazing piece of art. It's like, whose is this? I don't know, but it doesn't appear to be anybody else. I guess I'm keeping it. So she started doing this, kind of for her own amusement, but for to the surprise and delight of her fellow citizens. And this thing has kind of grown. Now, I got a little video here that was on the local TV station a couple years ago, and this thing has grown. And now what's interesting is that this woman is sort of a bandit artist. No one officially knows who she is, which explains why she's wearing this ridiculous hat. She's sort of like the equivalent of like Banks, you know, the English street artist. But check this out.
Monkey Shines actually got started in 2002 when one of my students and I were looking for a way to get happy because of all the bad news that was going around. We decided to put some glass out and follow people and watch them find it and then ask them what they found and get excited about what they found. It was completely anonymously a way to bring joy to ourselves and to others. The Tacomans have a wonderful spirit of adventure and they love to play along with mischief. And so over the years, more people have come to help put out items in the public, and more people have started searching for them as well. That's a serendipitous event. I usually hide, but last year I thought I'm going to drive around and see
statement going on there. So other people have gotten involved. Well, yes, dozens of other artists have gotten involved. And they estimate this past year that over 6,000 pieces of art were put out for pump shots. That's kind of amazing. From a couple dozen cheapers in it to going to this kind of thing that's out there. How cool is that? And again, it starts with one person doing something that kind of amuses her. And then she does it for her neighborhood. And it grows and grows and grows. So I think that is absolutely wonderful. Now, as traditions go, I suspect that, you know, having an ice cream in Clinton's soda shop is probably well up there. Of course, many of you who lived here as kids, you probably remember it. I had my first experience here earlier today. It was very good. So so these kinds of things, they absolutely do matter. You know, and to bring something like that back was important. It's not just a soda shop. It's not just a whatever. It means something. But this is, you know, part of your legacy, your history, your traditions there. And so when folks go in there and families, you know, parents, you know, bring their kids in there and it becomes a generational thing, that absolutely has resonance there. And these are the kinds of things that make for community identity and certainly create a lot of love in our places. And as far as Richelson's traditions go, I guess Santa Caligon is one of yours, very successful, sort of your, what is it, up there in the Calgary Stampede. Apparently yours is without shirts, apparently. How do we keep this going? How do we keep growing it? Because I'm sure it keeps, you know, it sounds like it keeps getting bigger and bigger and maybe more important. It's like, how do we add more stuff around this? Instead of it's how many, it's what, four days? I'm sure that the things get crazy for those 4 days, but I'm sure, okay, are there events that sort of lead up to it as well?
Nope.
Maybe there could be. You know, these opportunities for some other stuff, it's like, hey, how do we build from strength? What could, you know, what's something that, you know, could there be a Santa Caligon art festival that happens a couple weeks before that starts with, you know, something inspired by our history, by, I don't know, great Western art. I'm just spitballing here, but there's opportunities to build around these. These rituals and traditions are fantastic points of, again, of strength from which you can build other things around. That's kind of what I want you guys to maybe think about as we sort of move forward. So what might be the new old ritual tradition? Maybe there's something even older than Santa Caligon. Maybe went by the wayside years ago. Maybe there's a way to bring it back. You know, I'm not saying to bring something back purely for nostalgic reasons, but maybe you bring something back and you match it up with something new and a little bit different. Who knows, you might have the next sort of great opportunity there. But I certainly would encourage you guys to maybe be thinking about that. Well, you know, we always did this, or we've done this over in this neighborhood. Could we take that and maybe make it something citywide? I don't know. But rituals and traditions are great starting points for a conversation about what we might be able to do that would impact our city. So it's something to think about. All right, I want us also to be thinking about this idea of embracing temporary. What do I mean by that? Well, temporary can absolutely be one of your best friends when you're trying to do something new and something different. Any of you folks been to Times Square in the last 5-6 years since it became a pedestrian-only zone? A few. It's an amazing transformation of that space. You know, but when Mayor Bloomberg first announced that, there were a lot of people who were really scared about that. They said, are you crazy? You're going to close up the busiest intersection in one of the busiest cities in the world. And the local business owners, they were screaming bloody murder. They said, man, you're going to kill our business. Mayor said, hold on. We're going to do this on a temporary basis, right? So if this doesn't go the way we hope, we'll be able to undo it very quickly. So when they actually did it, it was very simple. They painted different directions on the road. They brought in some flower boxes like you might get at a Lowe's or a Home Depot. They brought in these really inexpensive lawn chairs just to see if people would like it. And of course, they loved it. And within a matter of months, it's very evident that this is going to be a permanent change to Times Square. Now, I believe Bloomberg had every intention that this was going to be permanent from the beginning. But in order to sell it to his constituents, to all those naysayers, to the people who were worried about that, he had to announce it as temporary. So that folks could come and they go, oh, now I get it, I see what you mean. This is kind of awesome, right? So again, there's all kinds of projects that maybe you guys want to work on here. But you know, as soon as it's announced, there's going to be blowback because somebody's going to say, oh, I can't do that, that's crazy talk, right? Well, you know, if you can do this as a temporary project, there's all kinds of ways. You take away so much of the ammunition around it. Say, hey, let's give this a shot, let's try this, and just kind of see what happens. You know, a good example actually came from Salt Lake City. This is an area, and this actually, after seeing something near your city, this actually made me think about this one, and that's one of the reasons why I want to show you guys. So Granary Road, so Salt Lake City, obviously Brigham Young founds the city. In addition to being, you know, one of the leaders in the Mormon faith, he was actually the city planner around that. Now what he mandated was kind of interesting. He said that the city streets had to be wide enough so that an oxen cart could do sort of a turn without having to do sort of an oxen cart 3-point turn on it, right? And oxen carts do not have very tight turn radiuses. So consequently, you have these immensely wide streets in Salt Lake City, which are great for cars and apparently oxen, but terrible for people and creating a sense of vitality in a place because some cars go super fast, and because it's so wide, it dissipates all the energy in a place. So interesting, the Grand Area Road District, which is there sort of south of their downtown, they're trying to sort of renew some interest, revitalize this area. So this would be about 3 years ago. They tried this for the first time. They did it for two straight years. What they did was kind of amazing. In the middle of the road there, they bring in these sort of shipping containers, they create a stage, they create a beer garden, and on Thursday nights, Friday nights, and all day Saturday, they have pop-up retail, pop-up performances, restaurants, and music. And it occurs literally in the middle of the street. Now, I'm sure somebody says, are you crazy? You're gonna put people with beer next to cars? Yeah, and it worked. Because, I don't know if you can tell here, but look, they did all of this, and yet there's still two lanes of traffic on both sides of this street. It is that wide. So again, this became an amazing opportunity, and this helped sort of re-stimulate some interest in Grand Erie Road. They did it for two straight years, a big success, and Grand Erie Road has apparently become one of the hot spots there in Salt Lake City. Very well done. Which led me to yesterday, when I was touring the Inglewood Arts District, and those both sides of the road, you got all this parking here. This kind of reminded me of something. It reminded me of Grand Erie Row there in Salt Lake City. Now, I know this is one of the target areas. You guys want to see good stuff happen here, not only just in the square, but certainly all around the city. But could you do something interesting there in the middle of the road? I know, but it would be kind of interesting if you did. And I thought that this would make such a wonderful backdrop to do something in the middle of the road and then do something with these exteriors. I don't know. But temporary, doesn't have to be permanent, but maybe you do it on a temporary basis, maybe it's just a little weekend, something like that. And we put it there in the middle, just throw that out there. I think that would be an interesting opportunity for somebody to come up with something interesting and fun and clever and interactive that could maybe go in there. So yeah, I want us to break some rules. I know we had the mayor and Zach, Zach's going to be going, wait a minute, hold on. No, but this is a good story. So in Raleigh, North Carolina, this would be about 4 years ago, January 2012, 5 years ago, man, time flies. A graduate student by the name of Matt Tomasulo spent a weekend hanging up a bunch of signs in downtown Raleigh. And unlike most signs, which are typically all about cars and traffic, these were signs that were all about people and walking, right? And I interviewed Matt for my second book, and he told me the whole idea behind this was to get people to consider the option of walking. So let's face it, most people will reflexively get in their cars to go even just a few blocks, right? Just out of habit. But hey, if you knew it was an 18-minute walk, 7-minute walk, 10-minute walk, something like that, you go, yeah, it's a nice day, we should get some more exercise, get out, yeah, let's go for a walk. Yeah, my doctor says I need to get, to lose some weight, and my Fitbit's telling me I need more steps. Cool, let's go for a walk. And so we started into this conversation in the city, and it worked. People were pretty excited about this idea. They were saying, yeah, we actually do have a pretty walkable downtown. Press coverage around this was universally positive. In fact, it was so good that a couple weeks after the signs went up, a BBC film crew showed up because they heard Americans had discovered walking in cities. That's different. All good. Well, unfortunately, someone pointed out to the city planner, in fact, it was, I think, the local newspaper, one of the reporters pointed out, said, excuse me, it appears that nobody had permission to put up these signs. Is this authorized? And said, no, technically it's not. And so they had to take the signs down. Now, fortunately, the city manager of the city planner were big fans of the signs, and in a matter of days, they brought the signs back under the auspices of a pilot project. Now, what this project really underscores to me is this fundamental fact, is that sometimes somebody's got to break the rules to get us to the place we know we actually want to be. Now, I'm a lawyer by training. One of the things I remember from law school is there's the letter of the law and there's the spirit of the law. And in between the two, there's a tension. And in that tension, the law evolves. Of course, in our cities, there's the rules, the code, the regulations, right? But then there's the goal. And the goal should be a better, more interesting, more lovable city. Well, sometimes our rules and regulations don't allow us to get there, or they don't allow us to get there in the most expeditious way possible. And sometimes you need somebody who's willing to step outside the system to help unjam the system to, again, get us to the place we know we actually want to be. Now, I get that maybe it's not the best thing for the mayor or the city manager or a councilwoman to be seen as the rule breaker, right? Because then somebody's going to say, well, the mayor's breaking that rule. I wonder what other rules the mayor's breaking. And I get that maybe we don't want to invite that kind of scrutiny. Totally get that. So, okay, so if you're in one of those positions where you can't be that rule breaker and risk taker, and you know what? Have the backs of those who do. Because when they're doing something like this, absolutely performing public service. If Matt was in the sign selling business, this would have been received very differently. But he's not. was trying to do something positive for his community, and it was taken as such. Now, you know who are really good rule breakers and risk takers? Young people and artists. Young people will run through that metaphorical wall and leave a person-sized outline as they go through it, and that is a beautiful thing. Most of us, we're a little older, we've run through enough walls, we're a little reluctant to do it anymore because we know it hurts. But, right, those young people, God bless them, they have that energy, that enthusiasm, go. And artists, artists will take on authority just because they're artists. And that's pretty cool. kind of a fun example there for you. So, remember I mentioned the Art Prize competition there in Grand Rapids, Michigan? Well, it's this juried art show that's been going on for about 10 years now. So about 6 years ago, an artist came to them with this idea. He says, hey, I want to do these Chinese lanterns. He said, well, you know that involves fire, right? He said, yeah, don't worry. They showed him the design, which is actually very clever in terms of how it will prevent any sort of fire from actually happening. And he says, don't worry, we're only going to do 2,000. No, 2,000, that seems reasonable. So they went to the city. The city looks at the design, says 2,000, they sign off, great. They go to the fire marshals. Fire marshal looks at the design, 2,000, fine. Well, of course, the actual night of the event, the artist showed up and they launched 20,000. Now, by all accounts, it's one of the most spectacular nights in recent Grand Rapids history. And 2,000 is beautiful. 20,000 is spectacular. And I had a chance to talk to some of the leadership there in Grand Rapids about this. And I asked them about this. They said, well, we might not do it again, except at the very least, we'd ask some different questions. Like, okay, fair enough. But privately, they said it was one of the coolest things ever, and they were so glad it actually happened. Again, 2,000 is beautiful, 20,000 is spectacular, and it takes somebody breaking the rules to get us the place we know we actually want to be. Well done. So, I want to share a few more of these love notes, these crazy little things to maybe get you, prime the pump and get you thinking about some of this stuff before we turn you loose on this last one. So, in Durham, North Carolina, it's March 2011, and there's a wedding in Durham, North Carolina. And like most weddings, there's brides and grooms and flowers and tuxedos, and there's cake. Unlike most weddings, though, there are 1,600 brides and grooms, and they're not marrying each other. They're marrying the city of Durham. And what they described as the largest civic union in history, 1,600 people got up in front of their friends and neighbors, and they pledged an oath of love and fealty to the city. And the oath included things like a promise to keep the streets clean and safe, support local government, buy locally, protect the environment, and vote responsibly. Very cool. Now, that's the kind of thing that sounds like, well, that sounds like a chamber of commerce kind of thing. Or maybe it sounds like something that the city themselves would do. But it turns out that it actually started with this one woman. And this one woman apparently really loves Durham. And apparently someone once snarkily said that it's like, well, if you love it so much, why don't you marry it? It's like, hey, good idea. And that's very Durham's Durham. Now, what very Durham really underscores is this fact that I mentioned before, that we're in a relationship with our places. But most of the time, we don't think about that. You know, I have these highly examined personal and professional relationships. Spent a lot of time grinding on those. When was the last time most of us stopped and thought about the relationship that we have with our place? Probably not often, if ever. And an unexamined relationship can go stale. It can go bad. So this was a great reason for people to say, wait a minute, I am in this relationship. And it implies a two-way thing. It's not just about what the city does for us. It's what we as citizens maybe can do for our cities as well. I thought that was really cool. This one's kind of fun. These are the gnomes of Oakland. So for the last 10, 12 years now, there's a guy who's been hand-painting these little gnomes and putting these gnomes out all throughout Oakland as he walks his dogs. And apparently this guy walks all over the place. And so what happens is he puts them like on utility poles, he puts them like on little windowsills, and at last count, there were over 2,500 of these gnomes up there. You do a gnomes of Oakland search on like Google Maps, and it's like popping up everywhere. And you know what will happen is people would walk in and they say, oh, there's our neighborhood gnome. Then maybe a few months later, you walk by and think, hey, oh wait, our gnome's got a friend. Oh, that's nice, right? So really cool there. But not high art again, but really kind of very sweet. So a few years ago, though, Pacific Gas and Electric, the local utility company, kind of got their nose bent out of shape about the fact that starts putting these gnomes, some of them were on these utility poles. And they kind of made this proclamation, says, well, the gnomes got to go. And people said, why? We love the gnomes. And PG&E said, well, it's a matter of safety. And folks called bullshit on that one pretty quickly. And I'm sure somebody probably said, well, PG&E, if your poles are that shoddy that they're in danger of coming down because of these little gnomes, maybe we ought to audit all of your poles in Northern California. And I'm sure PG&E quickly realized that they were on the wrong side of this particular argument. Says, you know what? The gnomes can stay. And they did allow the gnomes to stay. And that's kind of awesome there as well. So again, this little thing, a little gesture like that, it's kind of sweet. You repeat it 2,500 or more times, then it becomes a thing there as well. And sometimes you gotta go big. Now, if any of you have visited Seattle, you guys might be familiar with this. This is the Fremont Bridge Troll. Now, Fremont is a neighborhood there in Seattle. And this actually is pretty old. This has actually been around for over 25 years. Now, under this bridge before, there's sort of an underpass in this one neighborhood. And apparently, there was at one particular time, there was a lot of antisocial behavior going on underneath this bridge. So, of course, the locals are asking for, hey, we need more police, we want more lighting, we want more surveillance. Hey, help us out here. So I said, well, police are like, well, let us look into it. Well, along comes an unlikely solution or an unlikely group to solve this problem. It was the Arts Council. The Arts Council showed up, hey, we got an idea. How about if we put a troll underneath the bridge and scare away the bad guys? And that's exactly what happened. Because this troll is actually really big. This is a full-size VW Beetle that is there in its hand. It is that big. And now you'll see, there are always people in the neighborhood, especially tourists and locals, coming to take a look at the troll, to climb on it, to take a picture with it. So now the neighbors have another problem. It's like, all these bloody tourists are in my neighborhood. But, all things considered, probably still better than the antisocial behavior that was going on there before. Now, how unusual, an unlikely group to solve a policing problem, a security problem? The Arts Council. It's like, we don't necessarily think about asking them to solve stuff, but why not? Maybe they would actually be able to contribute something kind of interesting. Maybe we could ask the police, well, what would you think about, an arts and cultural solution? Again, why are we putting ourselves into these particular boxes? I don't know. But if we can kind of break out of these boxes, we might come up with some wildly different stuff and some wildly different solutions like this troll to a safety issue. And along the lines of safety, I took this picture in Columbus, Ohio a couple of years ago, and there was this bridge, this underpass. It was really kind of scary if you looked at it, but it was like it was this light, and it literally pulled me down into it. I just want to see what's going on here. And these programmable lights, they've gotten really pretty inexpensive compared to so much other stuff. And talk about it's beautiful, and it creates a sense of safety, and it actually invites you in there as well. So a little bit could be done with light, just to improve an environment to, again, attract people, and again, relatively small, definitely a lot of them. What else we got here? Oh, this was fun. Muncie, Indiana. So there's this neighborhood in Muncie called Whiteland, and it's definitely not one of the more affluent neighborhoods there in Muncie. And what they did is the community, there's a little community development corporation there, and they pulled a little bit of money together, and they created this Year of Color idea. And what they did is they bought a bunch of paint. And most of the time, if we were to redesign our home, we would probably pick out a palette of colors that sort of work together complementary, right? So that's exactly what the Whiteland folks did there. So they picked out this palette of color that actually worked together, and they bought all these supplies, and then they looked at the neighborhood and says, hey, what do you guys want to paint? And people said, what? Paint anything? Yeah, let's paint some stuff. So they ended up painting stuff, like the children's playground equipment, which was looking pretty shoddy there. But now, hey, that looks a lot better. Hey, can we paint our garage? Can we paint our front porch? Absolutely. So again, allowing our fellow citizens to roll up their sleeves and get a little dirty. There's power in a coat of paint. And this is a great example of that. This one's kind of fun. Along those lines of a coat of paint, some of you may have seen stuff like this. Painting an intersection. And this was done during the Shining Yellow Arts Festival there last year in St. Petersburg. And this was done in like 6 hours on a Saturday morning. And they invited people to come down and be participants in this. Paint it. Music playing. It was basically this highly interactive experience there. And this is in the heart of our downtown. And that was the finished product. Pretty cool. So again, maybe there's some neighborhoods here. Do you want some traffic calming? Well, have you thought about painting the intersection? Because I guarantee you, you paint an intersection, cars will slow down because it doesn't look like your normal intersection. It's like, oh, okay, so a little natural traffic calming. Now, maybe we get permission to do that. Maybe we don't. I don't know. I see the mayor exactly. La, 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 la. All right, this one's really sweet. So I'm in San Luis Obispo there, and the guy who's giving me the tour of the city says, hey, because he knew the kind of stuff I was interested in. So hey, come check this out. So we drive into this residential neighborhood, get out of the car, goes, check this out. So walk over and see on the side, it goes, everything is perfect. We walk around the corner, and there, next to like these garbage cans, says, the earth laughs and flowers. Wow, that's really sweet. Somewhere here, check this out. This says, pretend this is paradise, and don't forget your dancing shoes. And clearly, this had been there for years. Now, and you had to be a local to totally to know this was even there, right? Now think about this. Think about how much cement we as a city put down every year. Miles of this stuff. But when was the last time we stopped and thought about that as a particular opportunity to do something sort of beautiful and sweet and creative to create a love note? I don't know. probably not often, but I'll tell you what, the city of St. Paul, Minnesota actually had this street haiku team. And for a number of years, they were doing this haiku stuff where they would actually, when they would put in new concrete, they put in these little poems. Like, wow, nice. So again, thinking about this stuff, what do we got lying around? Well, we've put an awful lot of concrete down. You know, we tend to think about, you know, art as having to be a mural or a sculpture or something like that. Maybe it's something as simple and as banal as sidewalk. Yeah, pretty cool. This one, temporary art. Candy Chang, remember our artist from New Orleans? Well, after Hurricane Katrina, she and her team salvaged a bunch of these blackboards from the school. The schools were devastated during Hurricane Katrina. So these blackboards were not going to really be used for anything else. But she and her team salvaged them. And they stenciled this provocation. It says, before I die, dot, dot, dot. And says, inviting people to sort of put up their bucket list. Like, what do you want to do there? And this is the kind of thing that absolutely spurs a conversation. That's big. So people would come, they'd look at it and go, oh, and they grab, you know, some chalk, and they start writing some stuff. And this stuff would fill up, they take some pictures, they wipe it down, and fill up again. That's kind of amazing. It's kind of public art that engages you in a conversation with other people. Somebody's gonna write, I want to skydive out of an airplane. It's like, maybe I want to skydive out of an airplane too. Maybe we should think about doing something together. I think what's kind of interesting about this is this little girl, this one says, before I die, I want to eat all of the candy something. So she wants to eat a lot of candy. It's good to have a goal. There as well. But that's her. That's on her bucket list, and hopefully she's eaten a lot of candy since then. So well done. This is Andrew Anderson. He is an artist, a maker from Muscatine, Iowa. And Muscatine is on the east side of Iowa there on the Mississippi River. And I was having a conversation with Andrew. I met him in Iowa City a few years ago. And he's telling me about this project that he worked on. He said he wanted to change the way his community sort of felt about itself. He says, I love my community. He says, but the people in my city don't think they're very creative. He goes, good people, hardworking, salt of the earth, Midwestern stock, actually. He says, they don't necessarily believe they're very creative. He goes, I want them to believe something different. So he starts thinking about some stuff. And he said that he was down actually by the Mississippi River one day. And he's looking at the river. And for whatever reason, he said, the idea of the Loch Ness Monster comes into his head. And he starts thinking about this whole idea of a monster that's maybe lived in the river for centuries there. And he starts creating this whole mythos about the monster. So he goes home, he creates a Facebook page about it, starts writing up a bunch of stuff. And so one thing leads to another, and in the summer of 2012, he debuts the Muscatine River Monster. It appears in the upper floors of this old hotel that had been converted to condos, right? So he's working with the developer, working with the owners. And it's these arms are have those wind things in them. So like the things out in front of like an auto dealership. So they move in the wind. It's like, oh man, that's amazing. So this was up for like a week. And people were buzzing about the monster. Everyone's coming out taking pictures. Press coverage around this was amazing. And people were coming up to him that week. He says, hey, we love the monster. Could we get it in our building? And he said he really hadn't intended this as anything other than a one-off. He says, but you know, sure, why not? So now the monster's made the rounds. It's been in storefronts. It's been at the dorms of the community college, the public library, and even in the 4th of July parade. That's kind of awesome, right? Now, I look at this photo, and I look at this guy down here. It looks like he's taking a picture there in the orange t-shirt. And I hope what he's thinking is, you know what? One of us made that crazy thing. One of us. And here's a great example of an artist. Somebody who loves their city has essentially held up a mirror to his community and says, you know what? All that you think you are, yeah, but you are something more. That is important. That is powerful. And what an unlikely vehicle and a messenger to deliver that message. A monster, right? You know, nowhere in the city manager's handbook is there a page on monsters. Maybe there is, maybe Zach's not telling us, but I would worry if there was, right? No, but this, how cool is that? Again, these folks looking at this in a different way, coming up with a wildly different kind of solution than we might actually come up with. Absolutely a fantastic look. I think I got one more I want to share with you guys here before we turn. Check this out. Surprising, delightful, anarchic. I don't think people get permission to do this, but check this out.
My name is Peregrine Church. I make things that make the world a more interesting place, like a rainwork. Rainworks are pieces of street art that only appear when they're wet, and they're messages or images designed to make people's rainy day a little bit better. Seattle is associated with rain, it's fair to say, and rainworks just all needs to be as wet, so it's sort of the ideal Seattle art. So the stuff that makes rainworks is biodegradable, environmentally friendly, and completely non-toxic. The essential ingredient when making rainworks is the super hydrophobic coating.
Okay, let's see how it works on the metal one. Sure. So you want me to start on the shirt, all right?
That is a chemical that when you put it on the surface, will prevent that surface from getting wet.
What?
I was browsing the internet one day and stumbled across a viral video, and the video showed like really vivid images of like red wine pouring off a white shirt and chocolate syrup pouring off white shoes and people getting buckets of water thrown on them. Like totally fine, and I'm like, well, that's super cool. What can I do with this? It's a spray-on substance, so it made sense. Like, what if you sprayed it through a stencil? So if you put it on concrete, well, ideally it'd be invisible, so that the concrete getting dark, the water will just roll right off it, and it'll stay light color. The contrast can be used to create an image. The very first one I did said, "Stay dry out there," and had a bunch of raindrops falling. It was on a bus stop. And now there's about 25 to 30 rainworms out there. There's a lily pad and pond with rocks hopping between them in Ballard. There's I Heart Rain in UW. At Fourth and Bell it says, worry is a misuse of the imagination. There's today's weather, rain, in Fremont. There's proud to be rainy in Capitol Hill. There's hopscotch at the junction in West Seattle, and we want to make way more. I mean, it's gonna rain no matter what, so why not do something cool with it?
So how fun is that? Now that super hydrophobic coating stuff, you can get that in like any hardware store, and that stuff's been around for years, but most folks never thought to do something like that with it. So that is our challenge here today. So I filled up your bed with a bunch of this crazy stuff, and here's what we're going to do. If you had $500 to make Independence a better, worse, more lovable city, what would you do? $500. And that's what we're actually going to be doing here today. We actually have a $500 grant that we're going to give away to one project that you guys are going to hook up here in the next 20 minutes or so. So here's what we're going to do. I want you to break back up on your tables. Maybe did you like your team that you worked with? If so, if you like your team, you can keep your team. If you don't like your team, you can move to another team or something like that. But let's do this. Each of these tables, there's a thing that says, $500. I want a title and couple bullet points, and then somebody is going to not only just sort of explain it, somebody is going to pitch it. Because essentially you're pitching this idea to the rest of folks in the room. You may like your own idea, but you might hear an idea that you think is even cooler, and I want to see that one happen there as well. So let's do this. So break up into these teams, and here, well, here's the other thing. Unlike the t-shirts where it's like, oh, you can do one of these and one of these and one of these. No, I want you to pick one idea. Pick the idea, pick the one you love the most, send that one to college, right? There. So one idea per team. So we'll give you guys 10, 15 minutes tops. I want you to come up with an idea, a title, and then sell it. And figure out who's going to pitch it to us. So break up into teams, and we'll come back here, and then we'll have everybody present, then we're going to vote, and then we're going to give the grant, and then we can have a reception. So there. All right. All of in. Class is back in session.
Some people are in the bathroom.
All right. Zach, you bring them in there? All right. Okay, here we go. Let me do this. Nobody's blinded by that. All right.
I got him a trip.
Testing. All right. Okay, so again, you may like your own idea, but you might hear something that's even better. Okay, so attention up here, and let's go. What do we got? Well, I'll hold it one time, you'll hold the other, and then I'll take it over here. All right, what do we got?
All right, so we, as you all know, I love my city, and I love my city because I have so many passionate people in this city. So I would like to bring back a heart campaign, and it's I'm in love with Independence. And through the cells of the hearts, we could have money for beautification in our city. And I would like to do it and offer it to every neighborhood, and that money could stay within your own neighborhood for beautification. It's been like 3 years since the hearts were lived in the Arts District, and a lot of people did their hearts year after year. So if I had the $500, I would redo the heart campaign, and it would continue to not only connect us as the wonderful community, but it would beautify our city so that everyone can be in love. Thank you, Mayor.
Very good. All right. All right, thank you. Put that up there. That would be number one. All right, next.
Okay, I really love that idea because I bought one of those hearts and I thought it was really cool. So if we don't have to have any trouble with the city and putting the hearts on the poles, we can work that out.
I suspect maybe we might have a little pole with some of those.
Yeah, and they might be able to connect the city around. Okay. Okay, this is, as several of you know, we are in the process of redoing Nolan Road, and I'm the vice chair of that. So we thought that it would be good to maybe start Cruise Nolan Road, which we talked about earlier, bringing something back, which in the past it was not so great because it was with all the young kids and they all got in trouble. Oh, and by the way, the chief is here. He's agreed with us on this. So we thought it would be kind of cool to bring it back to Cruise Nolan Road, the Miracle Mile, and make it an annual event from 40th Highway to Independence Square, because that's basically the new district of the Nolan Road district. It starts at 40th Highway and Nolan Road, and it takes it all the way to the square. So we want to connect it, and we would just use the $500 to give a prize to whoever had the best and the greatest car that would, the coolest car. And the chief said that he would close down Nolan Road, and we could do it.
Wow.
Okay.
Turn that on its head and publish, you know, well-designed love letters from Independence. Could take the form of poetry like sonnets or songs to Independence, put those on broadsides and paste those around buildings around town, much like you could go and try to find them on the beer and wine walk and on the square or all around town. Put our own words, our own love letters, inspired by those from Here to Best around town.
Love letters of Independence. All right, well done.
Okay, so that was out of the room. I don't know what this project is. This should go real well.
I volunteered you to do it.
So Harry Truman had a sign on his desk that said,
"Buck stops here."
Okay, so Buck never stops. We're stealing an idea from geocaching. Think of those terms. Let's make some little real durable buck stop here signs. They're like this big, right? Your colors, let's make a half dozen of them. And in that same spirit, it's gonna add this. In that same spirit, we're gonna go, somebody is gonna go hide one on the Blue Trace Trail. Somebody's gonna go hide one, I don't know, behind Harry's statue on the square, whatever. I mean, you know, get creative. And then you, the geocacher, the public, whomever, go find it, and then the way this works is you go online, and that'll all be embedded in the item itself. You go online, you say, I found it here, you put the date, and then you move it somewhere else cool in town. Now, we're going to tell people they have to stay in Independence, Missouri, that's the rule, and we know that's not going to happen, but they're going to find their way to the little White House, so we fail the entrepreneurial test. There's no revenue stream on this. We're just spending money. That's it.
A lot.
All right, so there's a core of an idea here, so we're going to do the crowd surface idea to get some help. Slumber Party in the Park, it'll be on the 4th of July weekend. It'll rotate from different parts of the community. The $500 is for marshmallow. And the thing is, the ultimate activity will be a collective reading of the Declaration of Independence as a group activity.
Okay, I have seen this one in action, and I saw it about a year ago up in Canada, and we were very impressed with this. We took pictures of them, but it is basically, we entitled it Color Outside the Lines. And this town in Canada had this going on, and it edified and beautified the city, where people, individuals, families, and students painted those ugly electric boxes that we have to have, the utility boxes, the trash bins, the fire hydrants. It was lovely, and it enhanced the city tremendously. As a tourist, I stopped, we took pictures, we posed by them, and I think that we can start this in some of the major parts of our city that we want to start changes, and then see how that just enhances along with it. Get competition going between either students, some of the older students in high school or college, because we have talent, and we need to display talent. The best way to show your city is to display your students, and you can display talent, and then maybe if it does, it could be something temporary, if it does grow, then maybe communities, the little sections of the city can compete, families can compete, we can continue this going and just enhance the looks of our city. But paint is cheap, but it also is beautiful. And we can do this in our city just to make it look more beautiful.
Color outside the lines.
All right, so we were coming up with some ideas, and Art was trying to bring people together. So we came up with the pop-up playhouse. We would use the $500 that would be used to buy the materials to make the pop-up playhouse. And this is a playhouse that could be assembled, disassembled, and you could travel from the square, neighborhoods, dog park, different parks. And really trying to bring people together, get kids out to play, and that's kind of our idea.
Put it on wheels and tow it.
We could do that too.
All right, I like it. Pop-up playhouse. Well done.
Our first idea stuck to the wall and it fell off. And it had to do with painting the bridges, overpasses that go through Independence. And we figured that would be a great idea. Then we'd use the $500 for bail. So that didn't go. So we had a bunch of ideas written down, but the one we settled on was a comprehensive mental health services building in Inglewood. And right now it's kind of a little bit of an eyesore. And the idea was, has anybody seen the Creepy Clown movie? It?
The what?
Most everybody here has. They don't want to admit it. Okay. But, and this is a temporary thing that could be, they could change themes. That building has a lot of windows, and some of them are broken, by the way. But engage with some of the art students in the local high schools or people in the art district. The investment would be to buy material to cover those windows and then put artwork in those windows. We could have a creepy clown theme, Halloween, or we could have a scream theme, or our BIO says no, but some kind of a theme, and it's, like I said, it's temporary, so it could change. Yeah. People would be looking at it.
Much better than a broken window. Yeah, all right, so what are we calling this one? The window arch. All right, very good.
Okay, we're a city of old and a city of new, so we decided to blend the two together and came up with Harry Truman Fatheads. Maybe for the role like the Kool-Aid Man, but we thought that might become a cool juxtaposition.
You guys know what kind of it is?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Harry Truman Fatheads, why not? All right, well done.
Peter, our group is really moved by two of your ideas specifically. Number one, how young people are the leaders in innovation, and secondly, doing art in the city without permission. So our thought was buy as much spray paint as we can for $500, distribute those to high schoolers, and just say, go crazy. No, I'm just joking. That's a terrible idea. Our idea was we call square swap or treasure or treasure or some other sort of alliteration, where we invite the citizens of Independence to come on the square for 2 hours, and they bring different items that they like to swap. There can be no money exchange, but it's a competition with one another. So the winner is, at the end, whoever starts out with something small or we would consider insignificant, but then somehow through their horse trading and swapping abilities, upgrades to something awesome,
right,
they would be the winner and be given $500.
Oh, very clever. All right. Old fashioned square swap. Well done. All right. All right. Here's the thing. Okay. You guys in front of you, you should still have some post-it notes and a marker. All right, grab your post-it note, grab a marker. All right, one man, one woman, one vote. Remember that. Okay, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to read back the name and the number of each one of these. And again, so you only vote for one. Again, you don't have to vote for your own project. I'm encouraging you to vote for the one you think you'd really like to see happen here. All right, so number one, bringing back the hearts. Number one, I'm in love. Number two was the Cruising Nolan Road. Number two, Cruising Nolan Road. Number three is Love Letters of Independence. Love Letters. Number four is Geocaching, The Buck Never Stops. Number four. Number five is The Slumber Party in the Park. Number five. Number six was the Color Outside the Lines, which is painting the fire hydrants and electrical boxes. Number six, Color Outside the Lines. Number seven is the Pop-Up Playhouse for Kids. Seven, Pop-Up Playhouse. Number eight is the window art, the Creepy Clown window art, number eight. Number nine is the Harry Truman Fatheads. You guys know what the Fatheads are. And number 10 is the Square Swap Meet. Number 10, Square Swap Meet. So again, write down the number and the name of the one that you like the best. Hold it over, hold it up. And Tom and Jody are going to come and collect those. And while they're collecting those and tabulating our results, I've got one other story I wanted to share with you guys.
I don't know what the fat
is. All right, so my question here before I had something I was going to show you guys. That's like, you guys have a sense of humor? All right, it's great to do, so I'm going to put this one back here. Okay. All right, so everybody, we got those going? Okay, they're going to tabulate the results. By the way, they're going to have you announce the winners. 2-1, et cetera, et cetera. Give them a couple minutes. One more for that. All right. So remember, I talked a lot about potholes. Well, this was a kind of a creative solution to solving potholes. This apparently happened in England a couple years ago. Check this out. Not suitable for workplace. Someone in this room. Not that it's a bad idea. In fact, it sort of illustrates, you know, so that's why Ashley hasn't had a sense of humor about it. I once was speaking in South Carolina, the South Carolina Municipal League, and beforehand, I'd been to South Carolina before, and I asked the executive director, says, hey, can I show you this? And I showed her the thing, and she laughed, because, yeah, you can't show that. I said, okay, so that's why I asked. I'm cool friends now, we've been hanging out now for the last day or so. But again, if they start showing up, and I know it's someone in this room. All right. So the last thing I want to share with you guys is this particular story. Now, I travel a lot. I travel more and more around the world. And a few years ago, I was invited to speak in Taiwan. And it's actually sort of an academic conference. And I'm really not an academic writer, but I was very pleased, I was honored that they asked me. So I tried to do some research about, you know, where I'm going, who I'm going to be talking to, and I tried to find, to reflect something back. You know, so I took a lot of pictures and I tried to reflect something back to you guys. So I was looking for something that I could share with this Taiwanese audience. And I came across this website, this Facebook group, that was created by this expat American who was living there in Taiwan. And he started this project called I Love Taiwan. And it was all about photographs. And he had this amazing video that it was sort of the call to action for what he was actually trying to do. And he says it a heck of a lot better than I can. Check this out. It's subtitled, but hopefully you read all that. First, the idea is not absurd, then there is no hope for Einstein. Pretty smart.
大家好，我是Sean，我有一个很疯狂的主意。 可是我自己一个人没办法完成，我需要你们的帮忙。 那你还在干什么呢？赶快加入我们，一起爱台湾！
So that goes to show the power of a good idea on a Facebook page. It can be that simple. It's kind of amazing, actually. When I was there in 2012, this was actually in November, he'd actually not been able to create that mural or that piece that's going to go on the side of that building. But on their Facebook page, there were thousands of photos, including photos like this. I mean, just to pull that off is an amazing accomplishment. So the tools are there. They're just waiting for us to come up with the right idea that's going to spark people's imaginations and touch them in a way that gets them excited about something. And hopefully you guys have gotten excited about the things that we can do here. All of these are really good ideas. In fact, you should probably think about trying to do all of them. You know, there. And $500 is nothing. I mean, we could come up with that like this if we put our minds to it. So what do we want to do? And this is the kind of stuff that we should be encouraging more of our citizens to do. You know, most citizens start way too big. These are way too big, and then they get discouraged because it's hard. You know, big projects require lots of time and money and patience, and it's just running your head into the wall continuously, right? But stuff like this, we can do this in a weekend. We don't necessarily even need to get permission to do it. In fact, I think permission probably works. Let's not make the mayor too nervous or Zach too nervous. Let's see if we can make more of this stuff happen. So with that, do we actually have some winners?
We do.
All right, you want to announce these for us?
Sure.
And then give us the...
thank you so much for being here. This is thank you all for coming. When we're done here today, Blue Ridge Bank is hosting a little reception for us. So just go up the road here to Blue Ridge Bank and Trust. It's the 10th floor or 6th floor. There's only 6 floors. The other building has 10. It's the 6th floor, and we'll get to spend a little time talking and sharing our experience from today.
And I have books, too.
And Peter has books. I have read the books. I have told all of you, or most of you, to read the books. And Bren Schoenemeyer, who is right here someplace, was kind enough to make the library get books, so that but we want you to buy books. You know, I was gonna say what Peter just said, which is there's no reason we can't do every single one of these projects with or without a $500 grant, but here's the vote getters. Number 3 was the Nolan Road Cart Cruise, which was project number 2. Yeah. Number 2 was I'm in love the Heart Project and Independence, Bring Back Our Heart Project. And number 1, and the winner of the $500, which we will get to you before the end of the week, is project number 6, which was Color Outside the Lines. Group 6.
Now, here's the thing. Now, we can't just put it all on these guys. If you guys want to get involved, I'm sure this team would love to get your help as well. Maybe make something happen. Maybe we can get some volunteers. So people can actually paint. That would actually be a useful thing there as well. But I'm hopeful that, Pam, since you've seen the end product, if you'll take maybe some leadership there and pull the team together and get things going. I'd love to see what you guys do with that. Send me some photos. And I'm so glad that people are excited about it. You're clearly excited about that. So yeah, well done. So yeah, so that is that's our day. We're actually done here a little bit early. I want to thank you guys for coming out and playing. And hopefully this has got you guys excited about all the possibilities. There's clearly some great stuff going on here in your city. This can only add to that particular process. I've been very impressed with your leadership, both on sort of the official side, the business community, the folks who are here doing amazing things. So thank you for that. I'm also looking for a good story. You know, do something cool, send me a link. I'm always curious about that. And like I said, I am in research mode for my next book, and you never know. Maybe one of these stories ends up in the next thing. At the very least, I might be able to share it with the community down the line. Say, hey, have you seen what Independence did?